Hello and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we'll take a look at Postgres auditing. We'll look at two different approaches using triggers in Postgres and using the pgAudit extension. This was inspired by this blog post by supabase, where they're talking about Postgres auditing in 150 lines of SQL. They're describing how they want to audit changes to this table. They come to a solution that has a very simple API, where you say audit enable tracking and you tell it which table you want to track. And then you do activity on the table, like an insert, update, and delete. And that gives you a record history in that audit record history table. You can go and you can see they did these changes and here was the old record and this was the new record. But that happens automatically once you enable a table for auditing. They have this audit record version table and they use a print index here. Print indexes are great. If you have a particular ordering in your table, for example, an audit table, most likely you're going to keep adding new records at the end, assuming you don't delete old records. So in this case, a print index is very efficient because a print index helps Postgres locate the relevant parts of a table when doing a search for a timestamp in this case. They also added a Btree index on the table OID, which helps them locate a particular table's history. The way that they've implemented this, and this is really the key part of it, is that they've used a trigger function. This is a PLPG SQL function that is defined as a trigger on the table. What it does is when a record changes in a particular table that you're auditing, then it does an insert into this audit record version table. Pretty simple approach, nothing magical going on here. If you've never seen PGOP and pgAudit and such, these are magic constants that are defined when you define a trigger in PLPG SQL. As they showed earlier, they have this audit enable tracking API and it attaches the trigger to particular tables. Before insert or update or delete, this trigger activates and calls the insert, update, delete trigger function, which then ends up inserting a record into the audit table. This approach is great, and you can use their supabase extension, which they released, which packages this approach using triggers in Postgres. The one important caveat here is that the triggers on the table have their own overhead. If you're doing high concurrent writes, then you will notice that the trigger overhead is a problem. They do recommend pgAudit here. pgAudit takes a very different approach. pgAudit is an extension. It's been around for a while, certainly something I would use in production if I need auditing. The supabase extension is about writing things to the database itself, versus the pgAudit extension is about logging to your Postgres log files, and then you can retain these log files however long you want. The pgAudit extension doesn't do anything beyond outputting things to the Postgres log. I give this example here where it's doing a DDL, but it's doing it in a non-obvious way. If you just used log statement, then you might miss the fact that this statement was actually doing DDL. It was creating a table. The pgAudit extension has a specific method to track DDL changes to your database. Then you get this in your Postgres logs, which you can then analyze and say, oh, somebody created a table or somebody executed DDL. Really important to know if pgAudit is. pgAudit can generate an enormous volume of logging. It's even worse in a sense than what the supabase extension tries to do. If you just turn on pgAudit and you use the simple settings and just turn everything on, then you will have so much activity. It's going to slow down your database. It's going to run you out of disk. It's a really bad idea to just turn on everything in terms of auditing here. But that's why it's really important to configure how much you're logging. pgAudit does have a few mechanisms to control that. If you look at the supabase extension, it works on a per table basis. I didn't realize that for a long time, but pgAudit can also work on a per table basis. But the way it does it is not obvious. There are a few things in pgAudit that are controlled using the Postgres configuration system. You tell it what to log, and you can tell it log all select statements or log all delete statements, and it lets you control what type of statements to log. But there is no setting in pgAudit that says log this table. Instead, what pgAudit does is it looks at which tables it has access to. If the statement that's being executed is on a table that it has access to using the Postgres role system, then it logs the audit log for the table. But if it doesn't have access, then it doesn't log that. Generally, I would say the trigger-based approach that supabase described is easier to manage at a small scale. It is a bit more convenient. I would say pgAudit is the more reliable solution here, but it does require a little bit of fine-tuning with the Postgres settings as well as the Postgres grant system to make full use of it. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next episodes, and talk to you next week.